Good afternoon. I'm Marty West, Academic Dean here at the Harvard Graduate School of Education, and I'm stepping in today for Dean Bridget Long, who's under the weather this afternoon but sends her deep regrets. Bridget asked me to come and welcome you on behalf of the school to this special Ask With Education Forum, marking the public launch of the Black Teacher Archive, an open access digital portal that brings together archival materials from professional organizations of African American educators throughout the 20th century. And in so doing, offers a whole new lens on the history of education, the history of African American education, and the struggle for educational equity, a struggle that started long ago and very much continues today. As you'll soon learn, the Black Teacher Archive brings to light the incredible intellectual, academic, and professional contributions of Black teachers from the Jim Crow era to the Civil Rights era, drawing materials from more than 70 archival repositories that have preserved them across the decades. The project and its potential is remarkable. Before we watch a short trailer that helps introduce the project and then call our panelists to the stage, I want to acknowledge some of those responsible for today's event. First, I want to acknowledge the co-founding directors of the Black Teacher Archive, Jarvis Givens and Imani Perry, whom you'll be hearing from momentarily. Jarvis is professor of education here at the Harvard Graduate School of Education and a faculty affiliate in Harvard's Department of African and African American Studies. Imani is appointed jointly as the Morse Professor in Studies of Women, Gender, and Sexuality and in African and African American Studies, also here at Harvard. Jarvis and Imani will be joined in conversation by our remarkable moderator, Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham, the Victor S. Thomas Professor of History and of African and African American Studies at Harvard. We'll call them to the stage in just a few moments, but please join me now in giving them a welcoming round of applause. I also want to acknowledge several other people. One of them first, who is not with us tonight, but I know will soon be watching online, and that's Teresa Perry, who earned her doctoral degree from HGSE and is also an emerita professor at Simmons University, and the mother of Imani Perry. I'm told that we need to clap for that. I'm told that Dr. Perry was a driving force behind this project, who first convened Jarvis and Imani to work on preserving these historical records. I'd also like to acknowledge Micah Brodnax, an archivist and project manager who's done so much work to make the Black Teacher Archive a reality. And finally, I want to acknowledge and thank our team of librarians here at HGSE's own Gutman Library, which is stewarding the Black Teacher Archive in conjunction with the broader Harvard Library System. So with that, I'm going to ask our media team to cue up the trailer video, and then you'll hear a few words from Micah, who will kick off our panel. Thank you again for coming today, and please enjoy.
We've been missing a very, very important part of the Black freedom struggle by not including teachers front and center in that story and elevating the work of educators when it comes to Black collective struggle. Black Teacher Archive is this digital portal that houses the records of colored teacher associations, particularly their journals. These are digital representations of these physical materials that exist all over the country.
We're trying to provide a different form of access and also honor the care that has already been provided to the material.
Mm-hmm. We're taking advantage of what it means to live in the digital age, and with the hopes of kind of revitalizing some aspects of tradition, but also to say, there are things that we can do now that couldn't be done 20 or 30 years ago in terms of digitizing.
One of the most important things that can happen is that it allows us to tell much more robust stories about the role that teachers played in all aspects of Black life.
When people think about the civil rights movement, teachers are not necessarily the people that come to mind. there are all these individual figures, but then when you sit back and wonder, well, where did all of these great and important leaders come from? When we think about their oratorical skills, right? When we think about their ability to imagine a world outside of the confines of Jim Crow, where did they learn that?
Despite the extraordinary blooming that has happened in African American studies, we are still mining for the stuff of the tradition that we need to do to fashion, to shape the field, to tell the story. I do think that this project is yielding a lot of gold.
Welcome and good evening. I am Micah Broadnax, and I have the honor of being the project manager for the Black Teacher Archive. I'm granddaughter of Jackson P. Burley High School sweethearts Mildred Carr Washington and Ulysses Grant Washington, class of 1954 and 55, respectively. I'm daughter of Leslie Washington, who bore the discomfort and distinction of integrating her class of third graders at Stone Robinson Elementary School in Charlottesville in 1967, and the little sister of Anton Washington, a veteran teacher of nearly 15 years in Prince George's County, Maryland. I share this because as an archivist, I believe context is always important. The Black Teacher Archive is personal. It is also communal. The stewardship of archives is a relationship to care, to preserve the evidence of the past and make it available, makes possible the world of scholarship and historical documentation and analysis that so many of us have had the privilege of reading in the work of our three scholars you will hear from today. The journals of the Colored Teacher Associations were carefully stewarded in a multitude of archival collections. In special collections, rare books, personal papers, and even general library collections. We collaborated with public libraries, individual collectors, historically Black colleges and universities, state universities, and small liberal arts colleges to curate, or perhaps more appropriately, reassemble this collection. Convened by Dr. Teresa Perry, Harvard Graduate School of Education, class of 1982, heated and directed by Dr. Jarvis Givens and Dr. Imani Perry. The vision for this project was brought to fruition by archivists, librarians, and administrators at 70 institutions across this country, and locally informed and guided and executed by more than 50 librarians here within Harvard, who helped us in our efforts to digitize, describe, and make available the journals of Colored Teacher Associations. Our efforts were also aided by staff from communications to facilities. And so at this time, may you please stand if you are able so we can recognize your labor. I know there are countless individuals who participated and are also with us on live stream, but if you could please stand so we can, and I see you all out there, so I know you are shy, but I do want to honor that. It is a huge feat. Thank you. Thank you. If you didn't know, librarians and archivists, we're a little shy. But yes, you know, removing the barriers of distance to have access to this body of information in a digital space, we are gathered to celebrate a newly configured repository of knowledge, a curated digital collection, a reservoir for studying. As this space has been prepared, may we have the fortune of time. The relationship between the archivist and historian remains vital to documenting and preserving history. I'm excited and grateful for the context, interpretation, and storytelling these scholars have chosen to share with the world. I'd now like to turn our program to Dr. Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham, and may you please join me in welcoming her to the stage.
It is really a pleasure and a great privilege to be here on this special occasion. When I think of the giants of Black history, W.E.B. Du Bois, men like Carter G. Woodson and James Weldon Johnson, and women like Anna Julia Cooper, Nanny Helen Burroughs, and Mary McLeod Bethune, all of them being strong advocates of racial equality. I'm also reminded that they also all were school teachers at one point in their lives. So whether it was in the little school in Daugherty County, Georgia, as Du Bois writes about in The Souls of Black Folk, or the Stanton School in Jacksonville, Florida, whose students were the first to sing James Weldon Johnson's Lift Every Voice and Sing, or the famous college-oriented high school in DC named after Paul Laurence Dunbar, at which Carter Woodson, Mary Church Terrell, and Anna Julia Cooper taught, or the Nanny Helen Burroughs School. It was an industrial-oriented school as opposed to Dunbar's college-oriented focus. And her school, the National Training School for Women and Girls, was also popularly known as the School of the Three B's, for the Bible, the Bath, and the Broom. Now, I'm proud to say that after graduating from college, I taught both junior high school and high school in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and then in my hometown of Washington, D.C. In fact, I come from a long line of school teachers who taught in D.C. My Aunt Julia Evangeline Brooks taught at Dunbar. My father, Albert N.D. Brooks, taught at Benjamin Banneker. My mother, Elaine Brooks, taught at Shaw, named after Robert Gould Shaw, the famous abolitionist and the colonel of the Black Massachusetts 54th Regiment, who died with his other slain members of his Black regiment and is buried with them. Now just think of the names of those schools. The names themselves are history lessons. But the work of the Black teachers, their commitment to their schools, their own quest for equality, be it for teachers' pay or for the equal distribution of resources such as books and equipment for their students, and also the teachers' creativity, their resourcefulness, and their inspiration that they instilled in their students, provided their students not only with knowledge, but with the inspiration that instilled in them self-pride and self-determination. During a time when American laws, literature, the customs, the newspapers, just so much of America taught otherwise and sought to demean and to discriminate. But Black teachers, as we know from the Black Teachers Archive, did not confine their work to the schoolhouse or the school day, because their activities went far beyond the world of the classroom. And how do we know this world of the teachers? We know it thanks to Jarvis Givens and Imani Perry. They have brought their names and their activities to light. Their organizations, their networks, the proceedings of their meetings, their journals and newsletters, their political and social activism. Professor Jarvis Givens and Professor Imani Perry, we applaud you for the creation of the Black Teacher Archive. It is a major contribution to the history It is a major contribution to the history of education in America. So please join me on this stage and we can talk some more.
I want to make sure these are on.
Oh, thank you, because I forgot. Oh, I am on, okay. So let's begin with how the project started. I mean, how did you discover this? How did you bring all this that was unknown to light?
Yeah, thanks for that question. And also thank you for the beautiful remarks that you opened with. I feel like we have to acknowledge that.
Thank you. Yeah.
Every conversation that we've had over the years, you've continuously reminded me of both the kind of legacy of teachers in your own family and why you valued the work that I was doing and now that Imani and I have come to do together. So I really appreciate that. And, you know, the story about how this came to be is really connected to the kind of personal relationships mm-hmm. to this history, both for myself, but also I'm sure Imani is going to share more about that as well. But for me, initially, my entry into studying the history of Black education began because I had Black teachers my entire life who were many were Southern, born and educated and migrated to California where I was educated. I attended a small Black school in Compton, California, told this story before, where we sang Lift Every Voice and Sing every morning from preschool to the time I graduated in the eighth grade. And it wasn't until I got to graduate school and started researching that I realized that the tradition of education I benefited from was a part of this much longer history. Fast forward to the time when I'm writing my dissertation on Carter G. Woodson and his relationship with Black teachers across the country. And, you know, I started to become curious about these Black teachers that were writing textbooks in the early 1900s that completely challenged ideas about the history of Black education that I had been offered on TV or even in the representations in American history that told the story of separate and unequal schooling and nothing else. Didn't tell the story of, you know, Black teachers writing textbooks, developing curriculum. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was my research, and Carter G. Woodson was a major, major figure, right? The person who founded what we know as Black History Month. But it became very clear to me that Carter G. Woodson was not just one person operating in a vacuum, right? He was connected to a network of Black teachers who was doing this, and I wanted to demonstrate that. Lots of historians, when I was presenting my work initially about the teacher secretly reading from Carter G. Woodson's textbooks, would say, you know, how do you know that this teacher is not just an exception to the rule? You know, when you're writing this book, you're writing around fugitive pedagogy. And so I decided I wanted to track down and figure out how could I prove that this teacher was not just one teacher in rural Louisiana. And that required driving around to different places to try to find the minutes and the organizational records for colored teacher associations, because in my mind, one of the most reliable ways of documenting this was to say, let me go and find the papers of Black teachers professional organizations and to document how Carter G. Woodson shows up in those records, how Negro History Week shows up in those records. And, you know, what I found was I was able to find those materials, but it required a lot of digging and they weren't always easily accessible for research for myself or, you know, other folks trying to access those materials. So that's what led to me writing Fugitive Pedagogy. But then I came here and started as a postdoc as I was finishing that and had the, you know, wonderful privilege of meeting Professor Imani Perry's mom, Dr. Teresa Perry. We were neighbors in Roxbury, and she would always say, you know, Imani said the same thing when she was writing her book on, you know, about the Black National Anthem. You're doing this. She's like, you know, it's a shame that all these records are just scattered and not collected. You know, something should be done about that. Don't you think someone should do something about that?
She meant to you.
Exactly, right? So essentially, I was kind of voluntold to kind of like think of beyond my individual research but for the larger work that needed to be done. And I suspect, but I know that there was a similar conversation happening with Imani before we came together on the project. So I wanted you to tell your part of it.
Yeah, so it's similar. I mean, I guess to a certain extent, I felt like I was always aware of this submerged history, right? That was part of it. And in some ways, aware that there were stories that were very, not submerged in Black life, but were submerged in the sort of formal study that were important to come to the fore. And I started writing this book, May We Forever Stand, which is a history of the of Lift Every Voice and Sing. And immediately, when I first proposed it, I had editors telling me, oh, this should be an article, this is not a book, right? And that's because of an unfamiliarity with Black institutional life. Mm-hmm. And I knew that the stories that were going to animate the book had to, because I was interested in the song as a feature of Black social, political, institutional life, right? Not simply as a sort of
you know, sort of the details of its composition, although that was interesting, but really how it functioned in community. And that story had to be discovered in the materials of Black institutions, most particularly schools, right? Because people were singing it every day in schools or weekly in schools. And I wound up using both the archival materials of the Colored Teachers Associations, but also Negro History Bulletin, mm-hmm. Carter G. Woodson. And the biggest part of the story of the song, I think, is how it became immersed in the lives of children. So as I was talking to my mother, she would say, similarly, don't you think people should know about, you know, the Colored Teacher Associations? And then she brought us together. I always forget what year it was.
But it was in spring of 2018 at the ARA
in New York. Mm-hmm. We went to Le Meridian for brunch. And she said, with James Anderson, a wonderful historian of Black education, and she said, so, why don't you all do this, right? Yeah. And it became clear also the importance of digitization, which I was thoughtful of because of actually having done legal history, right, in the way in which digitization transformed what we could do in terms of legal history. And so similarly, I thought, well, this, yeah, we embarked on the project.
Yeah, we had a meeting at ARA in New York in 2018, spring of 2018, with the two of us, Dr. Teresa Perry and Dr. James D. Anderson, who wrote The Education of Blacks in the South, the authoritative kind of text when it comes to studying the history of Black education, was
yes.
We was there. So,
we were all there together.
You know, Dr. Perry meant business when she kind of called us together. And so that was the first kind of formal conversation, like, okay, we're really going to do this. And then we applied to receive support from the Radcliffe Institute for an exploratory seminar where we brought together a group of historians, archivists, and education scholars to talk about the feasibility of this project.
Which was fantastic,
And it was 2 days, and that was in, believe it was the fall of 2019. When we had that meeting for 2 days, it was about 18 of us together talking about what could be done to preserve the histories of Colored Teachers Associations, specifically these institutions. And one of the things that was decided was that, you know, the journals, there's a lot of records related to this institutional history, but these journals that Colored Teacher Associations published monthly or quarterly seemed like, you know, materials that should immediately be, you know, sought out and preserved. And so the first phase of the project, we decided, was going to be preserving the journals of Colored Teacher Associations. And of course, then we had to figure out how we can fund such a project. And, we put forward a grant with the Mellon Foundation that was successful. And then we were able to bring on the excellent Micah Broadnax, who really helped us kind of make this, idea something tangible and real.
It's wonderful to dream and to think that you can do something like this, but the real hard work of literally finding all these documents is at another level of discussion. So that's the discussion I want to have right now. I mean, what were some of the materials that you found? What were some of the, give us, just instead of saying journals, like give us some ideas give us some of those things that you found that were just remarkable, and do you have any stories about how you found them?
So for me, when I can just talk about when I was in the process of seeking out the materials for, tracking down the journals to talk about, Carter G. Woodson. Mm-hmm. Some of the materials were in the personal papers of prominent Black educators. So for instance, if I was in New Orleans at the Amistad Research Center and looking in the papers of George Long, who was a very prominent school principal in New Orleans during the Jim Crow era. He was an active member in the Louisiana Colored Teachers Association. And finding, some of the journals, meeting minutes in his own, papers, but then also reaching out to librarians and archivists at different schools. Some universities actually had the journals of Colored Teachers Associations as a part of their collections. Mm-hmm. At other places, there were folks that had them and had been you know, preserving them, but they weren't easily findable through the library systems or in the finding aids that existed there. And I remember once on that trip, for instance, when I was at the Amistad Research Center looking at the materials for the Louisiana journals, and, you know, suspecting that Jackson State, you know, in Mississippi would have materials related to the Mississippi Organization for Black Teachers, but they weren't on the, you know, they weren't listed on the library site. I reached out, they had multiple libraries at the school. I thought I was going to one place to find them. There was nothing there. And then I had a conversation with one of the security guards at the library who said, you know, my daughter's been working with a woman upstairs in the library and they've been, you know, preserving some materials here. And I had a conversation with her and she said, you know what, I remember someone coming years ago that was searching through these journals that we had for a legal history, actually, right, looking at these court cases. Mm-hmm. And so she goes back and she pulls out this bin, and it has just almost a near complete collection of the Mississippi journals. And the reason I was in Mississippi is because I remember one particular person at a conference saying, you know, I suspect that this Negro History Week and the kind of celebration of Negro history probably wasn't as widely circulated in some of the more, you know, states that were a bit more racially hostile. You know, maybe it's, you know, D.C. and some of in New Orleans perhaps is not the same as Mississippi. And so I was trying to write the book with the kind of folks who were probably skeptical in mind, not that they are the primary audience, but I do have to account for that. And so I wanted to find some cases for Mississippi. And this is what I was toward the end of writing Fugitive Pedagogy, and lo and behold, we are there. We're going through looking at January, February, and March, the months that Negro History Week would likely show up in the journals, yes, and they're across decades, right? And so for me, that was one of those moments where I was like, you know, not only are these materials really, really important, but also the work of preserving the documents and making sure that they're accessible for research long-term is very important. I mean, thinking about the question of accessibility, but also just long-term preservation as well. I think, mm-hmm, there were some serious questions that I started to think about in that process.
Yeah, I mean, I think what you just said really raises some of the sort of larger political and ethical issues, right, that are involved in this collection. So part of the challenge historically to preservation has been the unbelievable inequality in institutional, right, resources, right? So we're talking about historically Black institutions, both colleges and universities, but also high schools, certainly with the material related to James Weldon Johnson. Stanton has done a good job of preserving their materials. And so part of our question was, in collecting these materials, how do we function in an ethical way so that we're not just people from very elite universities mining these other institutions, right, to get their materials, right? And so this is part of what was behind wanting it to be an open source collection, and to be very, and Michael is an incredible leader on this, and to be very diligent about acknowledging the sources of, mm-hmm, the materials and thinking about how do we ethically engage institutions that, right, would have clearly been the stewards of much of this material, even if not having adequate resources to protect the material in the way that would be ideal. I mean, there were instances in which there were questions around even having the resources to process materials, yeah, right? And I just say, just to piggyback for a moment on the sort of the question of finding things and consistent with what you said at the beginning, Evelyn, I mean, looking, it was remarkable to rethink all of these illustrious figures that I had been trained through as not just as educators, but people who were active members of these associations, mm-hmm, for whom all of their intellectual work they understood as having as part of the central concern what was going to happen in the lives of Black children, mm-hmm, and how they ought to be prepared for the world. That struck me as an important intervention that was most clearly made by actually looking at who was at which and who's in these meetings, mm-hmm, right? And who's and what kind of service they're doing.
Yeah, and you know, some of the stories in particular, you know, were very rich and inspiring. But honestly, when we started doing the work and identifying, you know, where the materials were located, we identified over 150 different institutions and historical repositories across the country that had materials related to this work, whether it be journals, whether it be proceedings. And in the end, we ended up working and partnering with 70 different institution repositories across the country to collect the materials. This is the QR code here that's on many of the materials that you all have seen will take you to the portal, but I'm just showing you what the portal kind of looks like in these slides here. When we started to realize that their materials were all over the country, and so we have materials from, you know, nearly 1,900 issues of Colored Teacher Association journals that were scattered across the country and that are now, just the process of amassing all of these materials and bringing in the kind of digital assets to be in one centralized location, it was just a reminder of how organized Black teachers were and that they were intentional to document what they were doing and to leave a record for it. And that in itself, for me, was just, it's transformative. And I think it's something that is really important for us to think deeply about. That's what's, you know, kind of exists in the collection. And it really was possible. It was, you know, Micah did an excellent job of acknowledging so many of the different individuals at various universities and institutions across the country. But also the response here at Harvard was also great when folks realized how important this was. So the partnership with Harvard Library, and particularly imaging services and the digital collections, that created new systems to be able to build this online open access portal in the way that we've done it, where there was no model for it to be done this way before here at Harvard, and very few models for us to look to outside of the collection.
To pick up before you move from that point, for example, we full text searching that allows you to look for a name across states, across institutions, so that you can see how people moved. You can see what relationships existed between for people between different locations, different types of schools. So you can see, well, what's happening in Jean schools, which are the rural schools across country, versus what's happening in the more sort of urban high schools, right? Which did really, I don't think there is a model of anything comparable, right?
You know, one of the things that I found so fascinating was the celebration of Negro History Week, which you mentioned.
Yeah.
Because in, I think it's 2015, when they opened the National Museum of African American History and Culture in on the Mall in Washington, and one of the speakers was John Lewis, the congressman. And John Lewis told the story then about how when he was a little boy in Troy, is it Alabama? Troy, Alabama. So you know this is the heart of segregation. That his teacher, every Black History Week, because it was Negro History Week then, she would have them cut out photographs of Black people in magazines who had achieved, and then they had to talk about why that person was important. Now, you can imagine how inspiring that would be. So at the time that I was learning this, I was the president of the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. So I wrote this to, you know, for the Black History Month. I got all these messages back from people saying, I had to do this in my hometown. And then they even talked about how they cheated and couldn't find a picture somewhere, so they had to go to like Ebony or so, you know, because it was supposed to have been local people too that you found.
Yeah.
But it was just really interesting to know how important the teachers, just that resourcefulness, which leads me to ask you this question. I mean, there's so many exciting and surprising things. What did you, if you could think of what really was a aha, goodness gracious moment, what was that for you?
Yeah.
Oh, well, I think, you know, we recently, this is a bit more recent moment, but Mike identified, we were preparing really for this event, I was found an illustrious figure in the journals. It was Alice Walker as a child being referenced, and I forget what kind of contest it was, but I want to read, anyway, so I sent it to her daughter, Rebecca, who was my classmate in college.
And if folks don't know who Alice Walker is,
do y'all know who Alice Walker? I hope so.
Alice Walker.
You're right.
The writer.
Right. Just want to make sure.
Yes.
Right. If anybody's seen The Color Purple, we know that was a book before it was a film, right? Yeah.
In fact, she's the one who comes up with womanist.
Yes. And the person who came up with the term womanist. But her response to seeing her name in the journal was, wow, this is such a shock to even see East Putnam Consolidated School and to be alive to remember being there, my father, my mother, my teachers, everyone pulling so hard for us, building that structure themselves for us on cousin Dave Henry Simmons' land that he donated to the community. Ah, it brings tears. They worked so hard, believed so hard, loved us. Blessed be for memories of community that thrived. Ah, the innocence to youth, the subtle unprogramming. And I love that, Mama. And she's written to Rebecca. And so it's a beautiful moment of her sort of having memories triggered, but it also indicates what the material can do in terms of people telling their personal histories, right? The archives can actually become a kind of almost a genealogical point of entry, but also fuller stories of these people who we think we know a great deal about, right? So, you know, so, and then that last formulation, the subtle unprogramming, right? And it goes back to a point that Jarvis made, that the sort of dominant history that we have of desegregation is hinges upon a deficit model with respect to Black institutions, yeah. right? As opposed to it being a story of a demand for full citizenship rights and right and resources. And so this the potential for this to be a kind of robust corrective when you're talking about, you know, thousands of documents that attest to the intensive organization and the community organizing and the extraordinary nature of institutions that were created in the face of the violence of Jim Crow. So every time we have a moment like that, it's sort of magical, right? The sort of affirmation.
And there was, like, it's kind of become just something that we've been doing as we were kind of finalizing the portal. You know, it's just searching names. Right, so the kind of genealogical research and stuff that people are going to be able to do, the kind of local histories are just, you know, through the roof. But, you know, even for us, just searching names like Mary McLeod Bethune or Carter G. Woodson, or even some of the kind of local folks that were very, very prominent in their educational communities were really important. But I just, you know, put up a slide where another component of this is trying to collect oral histories with the last living members of these organizations prior to their merger with white professional organizations. There, in this photo, there's a woman, Mrs. Annie Abrams, who's in Little Rock, Arkansas, and who was a teacher and then a staff member for the Arkansas State Teachers Association there. And we reached out to her and we had an opportunity to go there and to do an oral history with her. And in preparing for the actual interview, of course, the first thing we do is to search through the journals to see what comes up, right? She's, you know, she's in her 90s, and we're searching through the journals, and one of the articles that we come across is an article that she wrote that was published in the Arkansas Teachers Journal in 1968, where she interviewed the oldest living Black veteran teacher in Arkansas about his experience as a teacher and his life as an educator, having been born in 1868, right? So for us, when we were preparing to go into, you know, to go to her home in Little Rock, literally two blocks from Central High School.
Which is extraordinary. Yeah.
It, you know, and then to come across this article by her where she was interviewing a former African, you know, an African-American teacher in his, you know, approaching a century, and we're doing this, just reminding us that the work that we're doing, the memory work that we're doing, is a part of a much longer intellectual process that Black teachers were central to, and that's in, you know, the project of African American studies that we do is a part of that legacy, right? So those kind of moments of affirmation, the note from Alice Walker, is just, you know, our like team meetings and thinking about the work, we're constantly just reminded about how important it is, and also that it's a part of a much longer tradition.
And this is too, just to echo that point, this is almost 200 years, right, in this moment in her home. Yeah.
But it must have been really affirming for her. She may have not even remembered having initially written that. Well, I mean, she probably did remember, but not that others would have read it and brought it to her attention. And, I'm sure if somebody had done that to me, I probably would have cried.
Yeah, I, you know, it was really I think that there's elements.
I'm so moved.
Yeah, yeah, I think she really, really appreciated it. And once she realized, you know, and so many other folks that we've had conversations with, the kind of project that this is in terms of, you know, uncovering the important legacy of Black teachers. You know, then she started in this photo. She, you know, brings. We didn't even know that she was going to hand this to us, right? She's looking through a bound copy of the Arkansas Teacher Association journals that she then gives to us to include in the collection, mm-hmm. right? She gives us a. You know, we didn't even know that it existed, but it was a kind of a old VHS tape of that consisted of interviews with some of the former members of the organization that we previously didn't have as a part of the collection mm-hmm. that we were then able to include. And we just imagine that's going to continue to happen in terms of folks identifying materials and understanding its relevance to the project and then contributing it in that way. So, but absolutely, she was extremely grateful and had so much to share the stories that she was able to tell about organizing bus trips to the national meetings because she was a staff member, mm-hmm. taking her kids with her on these meetings, right? So we get to see through the oral histories, things that are not always documented in the journals themselves mm-hmm. about the full lives of these teachers and the work that they were doing in organizing this professional world that they were a part of.
And just, you know, to that point, there's a lot of discussion in particular in African American studies about gaps in the archive. And there are gaps in the archive, but there's also a lot that we haven't yet collected.
Yes.
And we have to pay attention in order to actually, I mean, so, you know, folks haven't gone to Miss Abrams, Mother Abrams' house, right, mm-hmm. who are doing archival work, and it is her home. It's like a museum. Mm-hmm. She calls it a museum,
yeah.
right?
You know, as I think about this, the changes in the way we write history, so, for example, the Civil Rights Movement. Initially, when we wrote about the Civil Rights Movement, we talked about it from the level of government, the Supreme Court, the Congress. And then we moved to all these wonderful national organizations like the NAACP and all of that. But then where we are now, actually, it's not that we reject those, but we realize that the civil rights movement had to start on the ground. Mm-hmm. You know, somebody didn't from on high tell these folks to start doing what they were doing in their respective communities. Those are the names of people who have not made it into the history books until recently. Mm-hmm. That's what you're doing. Mm-hmm. You're bringing people into the history books. So I'm thinking about just fields of study. This is an important part, let's say, for scholars who do civil rights history.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Because mm-hmm. obviously the story of education is central to civil rights history. Mm-hmm. But I could see it in a lot of different fields of study. I wonder if you'd reflect on that.
Yeah. Well, I would just say before doing so that Evelyn, you are such an extraordinary model of someone who's valued institutional history mm-hmm. and Black institutions in particular. So in many ways, you set the stage for us to even think in these terms mm-hmm. in the field. And so I want to, be expressive of our appreciation for you of putting
you.
That forth as a model. But yeah, I think there's legal history, there's political history, there is intellectual history, because much of what we've talked about is thinking about this in terms of the intellectual lives of teachers,
right.
that they are doing practical work, of course, but they're thinking about best practices, they're talking about theory, this is a kind of sophisticated intellectual world as well as in many instances, they're thinking about tending to basic needs of young people, right? And also organizational lives that are actually, and this has been my particular interest, that is a precursor to movement organizing. Mm-hmm. You have the kind of interdependence networks, diligently kind of organized and structured institutions that actually are necessary to have a social movement, right?
Right. And that's reflected in the individual lives of some of these teachers that comes through in the journals. On average, most of these teachers that show up in the journals were likely members of at least four or five
at
different
least.
Black institutions
yeah.
or organizations, right? And so this, you know, Imani is absolutely right. When you document that, when you're talking about you know, the women's movement in the Black Baptist Church, right? And of course, the central figure in that work is Nanny Helen Burroughs, who you mentioned, and who was
a teacher. Well, in the 20th century, because there were teachers earlier, in the earlier chapter,
right.
The female talented
That's
10th
right.
was,
yeah.
you know, Spelman women, even before.
And Black teachers were the largest professional group. So it makes sense when we think about that, you know, the largest number of Black professionals, that they're teachers, right? And of course, they're across all of these different organizations, and they are the membership in sustaining them, whether it be in their church, whether it be the school that they're involved with, whether it be social and civic organizations, fraternities and sororities, and these different Black institutional networks that these teachers are really at the center of, makes for this network of political ideas and political organizing that becomes so central. And certainly even the kind of, you know, in Imani's work, thinking about how do we get the Black national anthem as the Black national anthem, right? That started at a school in Jacksonville, Florida.
It's teachers who spread this.
You know, it's fascinating because as someone who does women's history, most of your teachers are women.
It's women's history.
So
that's
a story unto itself,
yeah.
You know, which is quite fascinating. I'd really love for you also to say a little bit more about why the archives are relevant for our time. You know, we think about where we are right now. Why would it be important to talk about it?
To the point just that Jarvis just made, certainly we live in a moment in which not just one in which educators are often devalued, but one in which the work of educators is, even when valued, is often described as sort of the long-suffering responsibility to young people work, as opposed to intellectual work, politically significant work. And so I think that it provides a kind of long story about the centrality that teachers actually have for not just cultivating young people, but actually as this sort of nexus point for how the society is organized or how we imagine we might be as citizens or members of a society, right? And so, and this is really something that because I'm not an education scholar, that being in collaboration with Jarvis really instructed me on about sort of how this could have direct bearing on the work that educators do today.
Yeah, it's one of the things that we're really excited about is thinking about what the Black Teacher Archive means as an important foundation for rethinking elements of teacher education programs and teacher education, right? Given all that we see happening, right, in the world around us when it comes to questions around what teachers can and can't do in the classroom and things that go to the heart of African-American history and African-American studies, right, the legacy of this particular group of educators, of African-American teachers in the context of the U.S., is extremely important for making sense of this current moment that we're living in, right? And to understand this current moment around the politics of education as deeply connected to a much longer history of race and power in the context of schools in the society that we live in. Mm-hmm. Not creating space for teachers to engage in that kind of historical reflection, to think deeply about what it means to construct a professional identity that's accountable to this legacy, it means, you know, under-preparing teachers to face what they're going to face when they move into the actual profession. And so hopefully this archive and this evidence about how Black teachers organized, how the civil rights movement and the Black freedom struggle was only possible because of, you know, the labor that Black teachers also contributed to that will help us rethink how we go about preparing educators to meet the moment that we have right now and those that are to come. So I think the field of teacher education is also something that's really important, even beyond just thinking about social studies and, you know, English and African-American teachers. But I think about the larger kind of political and social roles of teachers more broadly is something that this archive helps us think deeply about, because Black teachers have always been aware of that, right? And they organize themselves because of that their hypervigilance about the way that they were constantly surveilled, right? The kind of surveillance and things that teachers are experiencing now based on what they're teaching is something that was a core part of the professional experience of all these Black teachers that are reflected in this history, and their professional dispositions were shaped by that, accounted for that. And there's a lot to be learned from studying the work that Black teachers did. And hopefully this is an opportunity for us in schools of education, this one included, to take that legacy more seriously.
Yeah, I mean, you give such a wonderful story about that in Fugitive Pedagogy, but I really do think it's so important because there are some people today faced with all the bans and all of this who are just overwhelmed.
Right.
And they're thinking, oh my God, how can we possibly do this? When in fact, if they look back in history, they could see that people did it in times actually worse than the
Absolutely.
Times we live in now.
Yeah.
And they did it. I love he has a quote in his book about my father, actually, who was a teacher, as I said, and who worked with organizations like the Association. And it was in the 1950s where you had the statement where he said, well, if they're going to do this to us, we just have to go underground.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that idea of underground, where teachers are working in churches and teachers, you know, they've got the school day, but then they've got this other not school day or after school where they teach. And if I could just share one of my stories with you, it's about surprise, but it's also just shows you how so much rich history can be discovered. So when I was writing Righteous Discontent, and I was writing about Nannie Helen Burroughs, and Nannie Helen Burroughs was a tremendous leader in the, you know, from the turn of the century to literally when she died. But it's just amazing how people get forgotten, you know, 20, 30 years later. And so when I'm writing about her, because she went to my grandfather's church, so, you know, I had heard about her. So I'm writing about her, and I go to the school, because the school that she founded is now a K through 12, it's an elementary school, I think. And it's called the Nannie Helen Burroughs School. So I go to the school to interview the president of the school then, and this was in the 1980s. So I'm talking to the principal of the school, And I'm saying, you know, I know it was a trade school, industrial school, but, you know, now. And she said, oh, well, do you want to see the trades building? Well, of course I wanted to see the trades building. It was called Trades Hall. So I wanted to go see it. So I say, sure. So we go over to the Trades Hall, and I go in there, and they open the door, and I see boxes to the ceiling. And I say, Dr. Downey, what are those boxes? And she said, oh, those are the papers of Nannie Helen Burroughs. And I now you talk about a surprise moment. I screamed. And so I said, you've got to get them to the Library of Congress. You've just got to get them there. So they got to the Library of Congress. This it's a huge collection. It is as large, if not larger, than Booker T. Washington. And she was involved in so many other things, and this is the institutional history of it. Mm-hmm. She's involved in the church, she's involved in women's clubs, she's involved in the Republican, the black Republicans. She's she might have stayed a Republican the whole time. But she was involved in so, and all this is here. You know, all of this is here. So, you know, this is what you're discovering, the same kind of, you know.
And there's so much of that work still to be done in the field, right? You know, so I think, you know, to lift up that point that Imani was making around, one, we have to be mindful that there are limitations to the archive in terms of what can and cannot be known about certain aspects of African-American life and experiences. And this is in Black Studies has been doing a really good job in terms of stretching our imaginations to think interdisciplinarily about, you know, approaching some of these problems. But there's also a lot of stuff that is there that that has to be cared for and that's worthy of studying and preservation because these folks were intentional to keep these records and to make sure that they were documenting the work that they were doing. And at the same time, as I think about that, it makes me think about one of the questions that I've been sitting with for this archive as we're trying to, you know, have conversations with scholars using it, is that while there's this kind of expansive record of these journals now through this, that are, you know, You can do word searches through them, search people's names, search institutions, that we also have to be mindful of what is and is not represented even in these journals, right? Because these are public-facing documents that the teachers were intentionally creating to represent themselves to the world in a world that they knew that certain things that they may have been doing, they couldn't openly write about in the journal. So we still have to understand the kind of public and private lives of Black teachers, right? Thinking about that quote from your father, it's a funny story in terms of how I included that quote with some of the conversations that myself and Evelyn were having when she was helping me think through fugitive pedagogy and why I needed to be, make sure that the language that I was using was accountable to the people in the record that I was writing about and not me imposing language on them. But that quote from, Albert N.D. Brooks and so many other teachers, it made me be a little more attentive to how they're describing things and how I'm writing about them, and that the work of a kind of a careful historian is, it requires me to be mindful of that, right? And to be nimble in my thinking in those ways. But, you know, these collections reflect something that we need to continue to do in African American studies, because it continues to be, as Imani, you know, often reminds me, it continues to be an archaeological project.
Right.
There's more digging that needs to happen, there's more preservation that needs to happen, and we can have those conversations alongside discussions around the limitations of archives.
And I just, you know, to that last point, I mean, one of the things that I think, even just talking about sort of what the archive shows or doesn't, I remember when Annie Abrams said to us, oh, yes, everybody was members of the NAACP, but they wouldn't put their names on those lists.
Right.
So that it also speaks to why the oral history is an important supplement. But there's yet this other piece that is among the histories that this archive speaks to. One is labor history, right? Teachers as workers, right? And having pressures from the institutions that employed them that shaped what it was, how they could organize themselves.
And you're saying this, but I guess just to be more explicit about it, when you think of the future of the archive, future uses of the archives, future uses you will use of the archives, future ways that you invite your audience to think of the archives, what are some of the things that might come to mind?
Well, I'll just say, I am so excited to see what various historians bring in all kinds of, with all kinds of approaches, do with what they discover. I just think it's a treasure trove. And this is part of, I mean, I think the vision from the very beginning is that we imagine this being sort of a site out of which lots of work would bloom. Maybe even a kind of renaissance of Black educational studies can come out of it. I mean, I think it's that significant.
Yeah. I totally agree with that. I'm excited for how the collection can easily, it's open access. You don't need Harvard credentials to search names, institutions, topics in the collection. I'm excited to see how it will be integrated into African-American studies, African-American history, and, you know, all kinds of history courses. But also, I'm really, really excited about the way that contemporary teachers themselves will be able to take up the material. And I mentioned that point about teacher education programs and, you know, some of the curricular assets that folks might be able to develop to engage teachers and what it means to think historically about their own professional identities as they're preparing to go and to do the work that they are required to do in the world today. I'm really excited about that. And also local histories, right? Even some things that are related to education, but I think most any kind of, you know, serious local history will require, you know, engaging in questions about education, or at least they should.
Well, to that point, I mean, I think, you know, part of what it supports is this understanding. We understand the centrality of churches in Black life. This will allow us to also, I think, deepen our understanding of the centrality of schools.
Absolutely.
Right, as standing alongside churches, as community oriented institutions that everyone, so to the point about local histories, you can see how embedded schools, people's lives were organized around church, but also around the school.
Yeah, I'm really excited from the HBCU angle. I mean, having gone to an HBCU, I can tell you, I think they will discover themselves in there. You know, their own history will be that maybe the school itself doesn't recognize, yeah. doesn't know that history,
And to that point that you're mm-hmm. lifting up there is a really important lesson, I think, for HBCUs and when it comes to education, but also even, you know, beyond that point, is HBCUs are absolutely strongly represented in the collections. Many of the, you know, the editors of, for instance, I think a Harper Council, Trenholm, who was the president of Alabama State, was the editor for the National Association of Teachers in Colored Schools Journal. But, you know, a lot of the pages in there are teachers that are not in higher ed, but that are in K through 12 schools. But what I'm saying is that this record also represents the kind of close collaboration between educators in higher education and in the K through 12 context that...
And they're coming out of those schools.
Absolutely. Right. They're being trained. They're going to school in, at historically black colleges and universities, especially the public historically black colleges and universities like Alabama State, like Jackson State. Mm-hmm. But I think it's an important lesson for us to disrupt some of the prosthetic boundaries that we tend to have between education and higher ed and the K through 12 context. What we see is people like Bethune, Du Bois, and Woodson in conversation with K through 12 teachers,
absolutely.
Sharing membership in the same organization where they're developing an educational agenda that is responsive to their collective needs as educators, but also the communities that they're all ultimately invested in serving. And I think opening up that conversation is really important, especially in this moment right now. And this is something that we've been seeing, having both worked with thinking about developing African-American studies for high school students and working with K through 12 teachers. We've, in the current moment, recognized the need for more of that kind of collaboration to happen. I'm saying this because I think at some point we all were involved in that conversation around introducing African-American studies in high schools. And that requires a conversation across higher ed and the K through 12 context. And more of that needs to happen. And they were doing this consistently, we see reflected in the journals.
So it's probably wonderful to hear from you.
Absolutely. So we have opportunity now to have some questions. Now that we've had a thorough conversation among ourselves, if there are folks who have any questions, there are two mics here in the room. You can go to the mics and then we'll be able to take questions and respond to them. There are mics in the center aisles.
Should we just go up to them?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for everything today. I'm curious to know, for the oral histories, are you guys filming them, or are they available on the websites to watch or listen to?
Yes, so we are filming the oral histories, and those are still underway, and they will be added later. So right now, the bulk of the archive consists of...
The journals.
And the bulk of the archive consists of the journals that were collected across various different states and digitized.
State histories. Mm-hmm.
Sorry?
The state histories, too.
Oh, right. The state histories.
Written by the organizations where they tell their histories.
Yeah. And so we're transitioning into phase two, which will then include these oral histories that we're collecting and also more materials that we're searching for to include and to fill in some of the gaps that exist in the current collection that... as it's assembled.
Thank you.
Yeah.
May I ask about the findings related to curriculum within the history of historically black colleges and universities and the present day curriculum employed in such schools? It's more of like a specific finding within the archives versus the archival process, but maybe have some information you could share.
A question around how curriculum is reflected in the materials?
Yeah. And
questions about curriculum?
And how it has changed from the historical archives to the present day curriculum.
Oh, I mean, I think that's a complicated question because curriculum is just expanded and there's a variety, you know, fields of study. But there are pieces about best practices in various fields, lesson plans. Mm-hmm. So there is sort of rich curricular material that is in, and even suggestions. So, for example, sort of how you might have. You know, what would be what's a way to organize a Negro History Week program, right? What kind of lessons should you have around it? Those kinds of things. So it's pretty rich in terms of a curriculum.
Yeah, and then there are, you know, curriculum questions around the lack of...
Like resources.
Of resources as well. So I remember coming across an article written by an English teacher and talking about what do you do in the absence of not having enough kind of text for students. And this particular article talking about the use of poetry. And poetry was very widely used in the schools, but thinking of sharing resources and strategies essentially in response to some of the, what we know about the kind of structural neglect of Black schools, but thinking about the creativity and resourcefulness of Black teachers, there are different things like that that show up. But also one of the things when I was doing my own research that I was really impressed with is seeing the organized ways that Black teachers were working to incorporate scholarship on Black life and culture into the curriculum.
Yes.
So for instance, I can think of, I mentioned going into that principal's, his papers in New Orleans and coming across this, you know, this, some of the pages that were torn out of a journal and included in a file. And it was a list of teachers organized into study groups across the state of Louisiana by grade level. And in the list of literature by Black writers and by Black historians that they were reading to think about how they could incorporate that into their classrooms. This was in the 1930s, right? So the question of curriculum is always there because for Black teachers, they always had an awareness that there were efforts to manipulate ideologically the kind of education that they were that they could offer Black students, right? There's a long debate about classical versus industrial education. That's a question around curriculum. But then also the inclusion of Black life and culture, right? That question has always been front and center for Black teachers' lives because they recognized and they named the fact that there was distortions about Black life included in the text, right? This is why we have Black school teachers having written textbooks as early as 1841, right, with James W.C. Pennington, who wrote a textbook when he was a teacher in Connecticut.
Because he was a fugitive slave.
As a fugitive slave, absolutely, at the African Free School. Is that question of curriculum is always top of mind for Black teachers because they recognize how power and anti-Blackness is deeply connected to representations of the world and human experience through the curriculum that are offered in schools.
And I would just as a quick supplementation of that point, one of the things that I think is important and that you can see really clearly to the extent there's material on industrial education is that industrial education is not like what we think of today as vocational education. It's the sciences, right? It's, you know, so what we think of as, it's still serious intellectual work, but also politically salient because people are trying to figure out how do you navigate in this particular, in the landscape that you occupy. So it's a more, so you get the more complex portrait even than the binary that is often presented, and you get a portrait of this sort of a more nuanced account of classical education, that it's not just a question of sort of high culture, but vernacular poetry is included in the classical education curriculum. So there's a valuing of both European classical tradition and the forms of art that come out of African American cultural practices, right? And so that's, it's really quite rich.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thanks for the question.
I was just thinking that considering that enslaved people were not allowed to read and could be killed for reading, that Black education is a revolutionary movement, especially in the early days. And I wonder if these schools and the early schools encountered any resistance. Did they burn down schools like they did churches?
All the time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, between 1866 and 1876, over 630 Black schools were burned down across the southern states. And that history of Black school burnings is definitely a narrative that continues into the 20th century. They were sites of surveillance and anti-Black terror. Black teachers themselves, as the people who were responsible for kind of caring and taking care of those places, were deeply aware of that because they also were targets of anti-Black violence and terror as well. But despite that, we know that Black folks created a kind of a counter tradition, right, when it comes to education that was not just responding to, you know, the kind of violence that they met in the context of education, but that was also projecting a vision of justice in the world that they wanted to kind of achieve, right? And that they were using as the basis for educating so many of the black students and folks that will become leaders that we think about and that we celebrate is because those seeds were kind of sown in the context of these schools, in part because the political consciousness of African-American teachers is quite evident in the records, in their organizing, and all sorts of things. Some of that is reflected in the journals, but much of it is not, right? We see the NAACP mentioned and named, but we don't necessarily get a full appreciation for the fact that, you know, the litigation strategy and all the court cases and all of the data that was amassed to support the folks like, you know, Charles Hamilton Houston and Thurgood Marshall in terms of the work that they did was collected by teachers and funded by teachers, right? They funneled money secretly to the NAACP to be able to do the work that they were doing.
They're state employees, right?
Because they're state employees and could be fired.
Right.
Exactly. So this is to answer your question specifically, yes, black education was a fugitive project from the very beginning. And these teachers were absolutely operating in that tradition because they had an awareness of the political context that they were navigating. That's why they organized in the ways that they did to protect themselves, because where one individual teacher was very vulnerable and susceptible to being fired, so on and so forth, right? These organizations that they created and that they funded could advocate on their behalf, right? Which is a very important aspect for understanding their approach to building institutions and the networks that we've been talking about that were so central to all of this story.
I do have a point with that also, though, because you said in 1861, and I was interested in like the 60s, what happened in the 60s. And I say that because, you know, the South did not have public schools. So
right.
In the North, we have what we call in Massachusetts and other places, free schools. Mm-hmm. Okay, but the South didn't have that. The South only got it during Reconstruction. That is identified as one of the great legacies of the black political officers,
yes.
The black political office holders during Reconstruction, that they were the mainstay of getting public schools into the South.
Yeah.
And so that political understanding of how important education was crucial. So if your project goes back into the 1860s, do they talk any about the political?
Well, they're not. The journals don't go back to the 1860s, but the organizations go back to the early 1870s. Yeah.
And even just to kind of tie it together with one of the narratives we shared earlier, you asked about the kind of threat and violence and school burnings. The narrative about Alice Walker, you know, we shared with her this story. She won second place in an oratorical competition at the school that she was at in Georgia. But one of the things we also know from reading Alice Walker's diaries is that her father and family members helped kind of raise the money to build a school in her local community. That school was burned down, and then her father and family had to then go and help raise more funding to build, to rebuild the school. And in the meantime, they held school in one of the local churches.
Right.
So that question of school arson and targeting black schools and burning them down is throughout the kind of history, but just even in an intimate way with the earlier narrative that was shared with Alice Walker. That's part of her own family's history in relationship to this story as well.
And I think it speaks to something that's remarkable. It's remarkable that people rebuilt the schools, but also going back to a point that you made just a moment ago, Jarvis, that people, that the educators were educating young people for a future that did not yet exist.
Right.
I mean, right. So we want to talk about Afrofuturism, right? The vision of the society that these children were being prepared for was an aspirational one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
So speaking of Afrofuturism, I think, Imani, you must have been reading my mind, because my question, and I apologize because it may be naive, and I don't know a lot about AI yet. I've been playing around with it a little bit. One of the things that I've been told and that I've read is that one of the potential problems with AI is because it uses the narratives that are out there right now to formulate what you get back from it. So my question is, with this archive, is there a potential for this archive to seep into that space and recreate perhaps the way stories are told about black people in the AI space?
I'm sure. Yeah. I mean, I went into that search engine. There's three of my books that are being used by AI engines right now. I mean, I think that's sort of a general question. I think that our question is ethically, what, mm-hmm. you know, how do we remain rooted in sort of serious research and ethical practices vis-a-vis citation and the like, right? So AI is going to AI, right? And we'll probably have some litigation around it, right? Some of the intellectual property stuff. But it also, I think, raises the stakes for us to be serious about the materials that we actually call our research from and to be attentive to that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a question that in the next phase, the portal is going to be open access, a lot of questions. This is a question mm-hmm. that has come up that we're planning to think about in some of the seminars we're planning to host post the launch. So I don't necessarily have a response to it just yet, but it is a question that we've constantly returned to. And even one of our colleagues here, I know Sebastian and I had a quick conversation about it, but we're planning to follow up on that because I'm eager to learn, but similarly, the ethical questions that are always front and center when doing this work is one thing that's always in the back of my mind when it comes to those things. Yeah, thanks for that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you all so much for this work. It's so, so wonderful to hear you making these strong connections to current teacher education, situating the work of teaching in a historical legacy of liberation, of love work, of fugitivity. You talked about the curriculum beautifully, and there was a question about curriculum. Back in the day, my dissertation advisor was a woman named Gina Anion, who wrote a lot about mm-hmm. the hidden curriculum. Mm-hmm. Dr. Givens, in your book, you start with a beautiful story about a teacher reading secretly. And I'm struck that teacher isn't just reading secretly from Carter G. Woodson's book, but that the person who's telling you that is a student. So the student's new. So I'm curious about the hidden curriculum and what, if anything, you're learning about pedagogical practices, not just professional dispositions, but what is it? Is there a look under the hood? What did it look like to lift every voice and sing for Black teachers? So the practices, what can we teach teachers today about the practices of Black educators from that?
Yeah, one of the big things is that some of this came through with some of the conversations we had about the institutional world that these teachers were a part of, is that the reason that student in that narrative that you're talking about understood what was happening in that moment, things that are unspoken, right? These are things in our households that we observe that are kind of, you know, whether they be habits of minds or things that are communicated even when it's not spoken, is because there's a kind of a shared understanding about the political world that teacher and that student is living in mm-hmm. that allows the student to interpret what's happening in the way that he did, right? That's not by happenstance. That's because when we have these narratives like Professor Higginbotham shared about John Lewis's teachers telling them to, you know, during Negro History Week mm-hmm. to cut out these photographs for Negro History Week. John Lewis in that same narrative also talked about those same teachers, you know, telling students on break about the civil rights protests and things that were happening yes. just miles away, right? So there was this political education that was also being offered to students about both the kind of injustice in the world around them, but also that their work in the classroom was about working to overcome and to dismantle those kind of structures that restrain their lives in particular ways, right? And so sometimes it was explicit, sometimes it was built into the culture of achievement in these schools, is that the way achievement was stressed to students is that it wasn't because of your individual performance on a test, but it was a kind of a collective vision of achievement that students came to understand about what the project of education was at this school, right? So when you start talking about dispositions and these sort of things, I think it has to do with what is the culture of achievement that these teachers and these school leaders have? How does it then translate to the routines and rituals that shape the everyday norms of the schools, right? That then shape the kind of perception of the world and the schooling environment of the students and the teachers, right? Mm-hmm. These are teachers who are thinking about these questions like very specifically. They're writing articles about it in their teacher journals, right? In terms of, you know, what it means to kind of set a school culture that cultivates aspiration for the students that they're teaching, who are taught that, who some people are invested in teaching that that they can only become farmers, not this, or nothing, or that they can't leave beyond the kind of local rural communities that they're in. And that's not to say that there's not important work to be done there, right? But who are trying to imagine a model of education that's not limiting the possibilities for these students, right? These teachers are very aware of that. They're working to help cultivate that in the minds of the students themselves, so that when you have these moments, there are things that are understood even when it's not spoken.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Victor Terry. I am from Jackson, Mississippi, graduate of Jackson State. And one of the benefits of my education is that I had the opportunity to have Black teachers who were teaching pre- and post-integration. So my question is, does the archive capture and muddies or nuances the conversation around integration yes. in the South? And what were some of the things that those teachers were lifting as concerns and celebrations?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that the archive captures, and it captures it to different extent based upon where you are, but the transition moment, right, when associations actually sort of become integrated into the mainstream organization, there's a variety of feelings about desegregation that are apparent in the materials just as there are in the sort of other kinds of political discourse that's happening, right? That I think is important because so much of that sort of complicated set of feelings around desegregation is a submerged history, so that mm-hmm. it comes as a surprise in the mainstream. But I think for anybody who's actually at all enmeshed in Black Southern communities, it's not a surprise in the least, right? Particularly given when you see how many huge body of principals who lost their jobs, educators, athletic directors in particular, the sort of deprofessionalization that was a consequence of structure of integration, which was not actually, or structure of desegregation that was not integration. Right?
Yeah, okay. I think that's spot on. I want to say in like 1962, there was something that was passed in the NEA called Resolution 12, which was essentially the resolution that was passed by the National Education Association that was forcing the state affiliates to merge mm-hmm. and to not have racially specific professional groups. It's important to note that the Black teacher groups never had racial clauses for membership, but the white professional groups did. And so what you have is that these professional groups are being forced to merge as desegregation is being rolled out, and you could imagine the kind of imbalance of power that existed when those mergers are happening, as you have things like 80% of Black teachers and principals being fired or demoted in certain counties across the country. And then you start to see, as the Black teachers are seeing the way that desegregation is being enacted or operationalized, some of them are raising questions, and rightfully so. And you see, this is that kind of mixed bag of feelings that you see showing up in some of the journals. They're actually pretty explicit about it, particularly I'm thinking about the ones from Georgia, where they're very explicit about and prolonging the merger, right? Because the negotiations for the mergers are becoming more and more intense as the people in Georgia see what happened in Florida, when they see what happened in Oklahoma and in Texas, where you have a Black executive director who had a PhD and way more years of experience, but who was forced in the merger to work underneath a less experienced executive director of the white professional group because the majority of the white members would not be comfortable having a Black director of the organization, right? You see all these sorts of things coming out as Black teachers are losing their jobs in masses, and as these institutions that served so much, that did so much important work, are also being dismantled at the same time. And so that's also part of how this history has become submerged in a particular way because of that moment in history and that rupture, right? That rupture that happened with the dismantling of these organizations, the massive firing of teachers. And we're still trying to uncover and make sense of that. But you absolutely see those distinctions. And there's an interesting generational divide as well. Some of the younger teachers, the older leaders of these organizations are seeing what's happening around them and become very, very critical However, some of the younger teachers in the organizations are, when we see this happening in the 60s and stuff, are really kind of pro and pushing for the desegregation, and they're all invested in these higher ideals, but some practically they're seeing what's happening around them, and there's a range of responses that we see in those moments that we still are trying to make sense of, and I think there's lots of important work to be done with people that might go to the archive to ask these kinds of questions that you're posing.
And just a sort of Jackson-specific reference point, I mean, one of the ways that it can, I think, facilitate the way we tell history is that we can start to think about how the turn to black nationalism, and in particular in education as well, is actually responsive to the failures of the project of desegregation, right? Which people often just think, oh, so, you know, suddenly black people turn their attention to, why do they not like integration anymore? That's actually, it's a refusal of integration that leads to this turn back to the kind of formations that existed pre-desegregation.
Absolutely, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Sorry. Good evening. My name is Bryant. I'm a teacher candidate within the social studies cohort, hoping to teach ethnic studies in high school. And as a black teacher, I'm really moved and inspired and grateful for the work that y'all put together for us to learn from. And my question is around like the professional identity. As a teacher candidate, as a black teacher candidate, but there's also other folks here who are also candidates, do you mind speaking more towards within the context of the archives, but also beyond, like what to consider or look for when thinking about shaping our own professional identities as a teacher? Because, you know, the work that we do is not just like teaching content, but it's more beyond that. And, you know, you've alluded to cultivating aspiration, you alluded to labor history. So do you mind just speaking more to what that looks like and things that teacher candidates should consider?
Yeah, thanks for that question. I would say that, and I appreciated the point that you shared that the work of teachers is not just about subject area expertise, right? But there's more to the professional identity of teachers than that. And I do think that leaning into some of and returning regularly to first questions around education, right? You know, what is the work of teachers in the larger social order, right? How can teachers contribute to social transformation, right? Being clear about what the political project of education is, that is kind of in terms of the systems that you're operating within, because oftentimes those concerns may not always be in alignment with what might have motivated you to become a teacher. And these are, you know, self-reflective questions, but they're also deep intellectual questions as well. And I think so it requires leaning into the intellectual demands of what it means to be a teacher, is that you are more than just someone who's supposed to come and teach students, you know, to prepare for exam after exam after exam from one year to the next, but that you are, you know, co-constructing knowledge in classrooms with students, right, and making the acquisition of knowledge possible, but that also means that you have to make and reflect on, like, what constitutes knowledge, right? What perspectives are worth valuing when it comes to shaping content for my classrooms, right? Those are decisions that teachers have to make, and you have to find room to lean into those kind of intellectual questions that may not always be encouraged by administrators and sometimes in teacher preparation programs either, right? Because I think this is one of the larger demands in terms of how the profession of teaching has been so debased in the society that we live in. Everyone talks about the challenges of education, but then they discourage people who they see as the best and brightest from becoming teachers, right? And how do we make sense of that? That's reflective of a cultural crisis that we have in the world that we live in. And teachers have to create room for themselves and for their students to interrogate that and to refuse that and to think beyond that. So I think leaning into the intellectual demands of teaching, you know, studying the history of the profession that you're in, right? And thinking about what pedagogical traditions do you want to be in relationship with? Do you understand as informing your identity? And that's essentially the work that these teachers were doing, and they were not always getting it from the sites that were training teachers, right? They had to create these organizations in order to do that.
I was just going to say, it's in your shirt, Black Scholars. I mean, I do think, and this is echoing your point, but I think just as a slight nuance to it, all educators live the life of the mind.
Yes.
And we do it. We do it at times. Sometimes it's a drudge, but at its best, it's an extraordinarily beautiful enterprise. We're thinking about thinking an awful lot. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks. And I think this is the last question here, and then we're going to have to wrap up.
Hi, Professor Givens. First, I want to say I'm a proud graduate of Stanton College Prep.
Yay!
And so is my grandfather and his sister and my godmother. So thank you for that work. Mm. Also, before them, their mother was a graduate of what was called the Boylan Haven Schools.
Mm.
So I'm wondering how the archives have addressed the network of Black boarding schools like the Mather School, the Gilbert School. How do they show up in these documents?
We haven't sort of thought about it yet sort of structurally, but they're present, like in the Kentucky archives. Mm-hmm. There's a lot about Lincoln Institute, for example, that includes the history of why it became a boarding school, mm-hmm. which had to do with, you know,
right.
not wanting Black people to move into that part of Kentucky.
So or even thinking about like the Piney Woods School in
Mississippi. Shows, yes.
They
right.
show up. We haven't taken up that question ourselves, but they absolutely yeah. show up in the records. And it's waiting for someone to come and pose that question. To
That's right. That might be your work.
About it. Yeah. we're at time. So we hope that you will all join us across the street for a reception. Okay. There are drinks and food that's been prepared. And there's also a wonderful exhibit of some of the materials from the collection that are on display in the gallery that was put together by a postdoctoral fellow, Rebecca Horitz-Willis, and also Micah Broadnax. So thank you so much for coming out.
Yes.
We look forward to answering more questions.